So when we started our research, our primary aim was to have and to register anti-cancer drug for human use. And to do that, of course, we have to carry out clinical trials, phase 2, phase 3 clinical trials. The only clinical trials we could complete that was a phase 2 clinical trial, double-blind with prostate cancer patient. And special thanks to András Kovács and Guler Imre and their colleagues who helped us several years ago to run that kind of experiment. So that was, I could say, a prospective study, double-blind. In the study we designed that, the study was designed for 4 months. The two arms of the study consumed, everybody received the normal conventional therapy. And the treated arms consumed normal deuterium-depleted water with 85 ppm. The placebo group consumed normal water. At the end of the evaluation, we evaluated 44 patients. Just by chance, 22 belongs to the treated group and 22 belongs to the control group. It is very important to see at the beginning whether the two arms is homogeneous. So I compare that the patients were involved the stage according to stage. So we could say the stage A, B, C, and 0, 2, 6, 8, 5, 6, 6, 8, 9. So we could say that no real difference between the two arms of the study. When we checked the number of medications this patient received, we could see always that there isn't any real difference between the two arms of the clinical study. Then we checked what type of treatment this patient received, and here are the different therapies we used in the clinical trial, and we also can see that no real difference in the two arms. So we can say that regarding the staging, the number of treatment, and the type of treatment, there wasn't any differences between the two arms of the clinical trial. There was one difference which wasn't significant, but just unfortunately, we found that anaplastic adenocarcinoma was diagnosed in 4 cases in the placebo group and only 1 case in the treated group. And the point is that this has a much worse prognosis, the anaplastic carcinoma, and that person who belongs to the treated group, he improved. The other 4 didn't show any improvement, and that could be some disturbing parameter, but otherwise the two arms were almost the same. So we followed a couple of parameters. One of them was to see the PSA value, and we could see that marked improvement was in 15 cases in the treated arms and in 9 cases in the placebo. It means that we could see over 50% reduction in the PSA level. The other was almost the same in the two group. Every month, the size of the prostate was measured by ultrasound, and when we checked and see the cumulative changes in the prostate size, we found that in the treated group, there was 160 cube centimeter decrease in the prostate size and only 54 cube centimeter in the placebo group. And I think this is the reason that when we checked urination problems, 8 patients we could solve the urination problems within the 4 months period, and only none of the patients seized these type of problems. So we could see that those patients who had a chance to consume deuterium-depleted water, we could find reduction in the PSA, they could find a smaller prostate, and the symptoms disappeared. At the end of the trial, those physicians who took part, they finally said, and considering all the changes, that 7 patients showed partial response in the treated arm and only 1 in the control arm, and we could say that significantly higher was the good responding patient number in the treated comparing to the control. This is no change and progression of disease for 8, but we could say that ratio was significant. When, as I mentioned, that whole trial lasted only for 4 months, and I I maybe I was wrong, but the reason that I chose that 4 month period was that the very first patient who consumed deuterium-depleted water with prostate cancer, it was my friend's father, who was a physician, and he was diagnosed with an inoperable prostate cancer in 1992, and 1 month later he started to consume water. Nobody could find by palpation the tumor, and he died 11 years later. So that was the reason that we chose the 4 month period. But when we checked the survival, we found that finally 2 people died within 1 year, and 9 people died in the placebo group within 1 year period. And we again can say that significantly higher was the death rate in the placebo group, and significantly longer was the lifespan in the treated group. After 2 years, we couldn't maintain the significance between the two arms regarding the death rate. So we know that this is only one prospective study, and this is not enough to claim and say, okay, we have solved the cancer problem. But we have been spent lots of time to follow patients who had been consuming deuterium-depleted water. It means we have a huge database, and we can make some homogeneous population. So we have our database, beside these 44 patients, 91 prostate cancer patients who are taking DDW longer than 19 days. The cumulative follow-up of these patients from the diagnosis is 350 years. These patients consumed over 130 years deuterium-depleted water, and from the start of DDW treatment, we have a follow-up over 200 years. And when we, without any selection, when we check the median survival time of this population, we found that it is 11 years. I cannot say that with the same composition of this population, what would be the median survival time, but I could say that it's much smaller number. And when we go into detail and see the composition of this 91 patient, we could say that 46 patients had a distant metastasis during the follow-up period, and 54 didn't have, they were free of metastasis. And if we go further, we could say that 33 patients had a metastasis limited to bone, 10 had metastasis in other organs, and 3 patients had secondary tumor. So if we go that way, we could say 32 patients had adenocarcinoma, one in anaplastic adenocarcinoma, and we can make 2 groups from these 32. 20 patients had bone metastasis within 1 year after the DDW treatment, and 12 patients received bone metastasis later than 1 year. So we could say this 20 patient is a homogeneous, and these 12 was a homogeneous population. So we checked the median survival time of the 20 patient, and in that case we could get a 64.8 months median survival time. If we compare it with a historical control, what we can see in the literature, it should be about 15-20 months. So we could say that there was a big increase in the median survival time in that small group of patients. And just an example of why we can get increase, why we could increase the median survival time. So here is one example with a patient who had a PSA level over 1,000 in 2002. And of course, he received conventional therapy and hormone therapy, and there was a decrease in the PSA level, and he started to consume water. That means the DDW consumption, and this is the PSA level. And in the last 8 years, we could keep the PSA level low and no any complaint, and he's fine. Another patient, he started 5 years ago with over a 500 PSA, and it went down, and you could see the cause-effect relationship. When he stopped drinking DDW, the PSA went up, he started to consume again, the PSA goes down, he stopped again, up, he started again, we could stop again the PSA level. He stopped consuming water last year in January, and he is planning to start again to consume deuterium-depleted water. So that would be a couple of examples that why could we keep the people alive with in a bone metastasis. So if you go to that group with 12 patients and the metastasis appeared 1 year later that they started to consume DDW, we in the cumulative follow-up period is 103 years, and two patients died out of 12, so we were not able to calculate the median survival time. So maybe 10 years later, we can calculate the median survival time of this population. And this is an example. So there was a prostatectomy in that case, in that patient, but the PSA level was still high, and it was very probably that some metastasis is present, and that person very regularly repeat the cure. 6 years after that, his PSA is low and he's tumor-free. And here's another example. He just died. He lived in Austria, and he had a prostatectomy 13 years ago. He started to consume deuterium-depleted water 11 years ago, and he consumed for a very long period of time. Then there was a break, and then start again. And for very long, there was a long break here. There was an increase in PSA level. At that time, he started to consume again. We could stop the PSA, but after that, we couldn't stop the PSA increase. And I just received a letter from his wife that he had passed, unfortunately. Okay, if we go back to the other population, these 45 patients who were tumor-free and metastasis-free, here is a median survival time. So in that case, the cumulative follow-up is 157 years, and four patients died out of 45. And again, we were not able to calculate the median survival time. And we think that we can prevent the metastasis because these people regularly consume deuterium-depleted water. Okay, conclusion. So the phase 2 double-blind clinical trial indicated the anti-cancer effect of deuterium depletion because PSA level decreased, prostate volume decreased, urination problem were ceased, and the death rate and the survival decreased, and the survival time increased. We say that the prospective study showed a 2-3-fold increase in the median survival time, and we could say that the administration of DDW increased the life expectancy of patients having bone metastasis. And we also can say that consumption of DDW delay or prevent the appearance of distant metastasis. Thank you for your attention.
Any comments, questions?
Actually, I've got a couple of questions from the first part of your study, of your clinical study, the prospective bit. I remember, I'm not sure whether I may have missed this, but you have your clinical outcome that you measured was the size of the prostate and the urination, wasn't it?
The primary endpoint was the how can we increase,
yes,
and what will be the reaction, partial response and complete response and no change.
Yes.
And the primary endpoint was whether we can increase the ratio or complete response or partial response significantly between the two arms.
That's right.
And to decide whether it's partial response or complete response, we followed a couple of parameters of the patient.
All right. I was wondering whether have you looked at the level of PSA?
Yeah, this is what I mentioned, that in 15 cases there was over 50% decrease in the PSA level.
And also, did you have some sort of exclusion and inclusion criteria? Couldn't we say exclude the four patients in placebo arm with adenocarcinoma?
We didn't exclude them. We simply recognized that unfortunately there was some heterogeneity between the two arms, and that maybe helped or ruined the efficacy in the placebo arm.
So what were then the exact inclusion and exclusion criteria for your patients?
The exclusion criteria was the body weight over 100 kilogram, we excluded the patient, and in a terminal phase, and we talk about, I think, 6 months life expectancy. Otherwise, I know today I would plan a different clinical trial, and maybe we should have focus on one or two stages, for example, of the patient that would help us. But at that time, my idea was that we will see the effect. I think we saw the effect, and that was the reason that, for example, the people from different stage were involved in the trial.
Some other questions? Thank you very much, Dr. Somlyai.